we're catching up pretty well with that missed day that we had at the beginning of the term. So today, I'm going to talk about some stuff. It's going to take a little while to get through, as you will see. But it's interesting stuff, and it is stuff that we don't know as much about as we ought to. And that's cholesterol. I told you that there were something like 9 Nobel Prizes that had been won for cholesterol, and there's still some pretty good components about cholesterol that we don't understand. So one of the things students find as I talk about this is it's oftentimes kind of unsatisfying, simply because we don't have the answer to some of these questions that are probably going to pop up in your head. Maybe there's a Nobel Prize for you to go and pursue. When I talk about cholesterol, I mentioned in class earlier that there's really three ways that we have cholesterol in our body: diet, synthesis, and storage. Okay? And so when we look at the overall picture of cholesterol in our body, those three things all have to be taken into account. As I mentioned, with respect to cholesterol, when you go to the doctor and the doctor says you have high cholesterol and we've got to get that reduced, the first thing they'll try to do is reduce dietary cholesterol and see if that has any significant impact on your cholesterol levels. It's always better to adjust things without a drug if you can compared to doing it with a drug. So that's reasonable. What I want to talk about here is a little bit about how cholesterol makes it into your system through diet. And that's not just cholesterol, but that's lipids in general. So cholesterol is a lipid, and cholesterol travels like lipids do. We'll see that there are some differences between the way cholesterol travels and the way that fat, for example, travels. But in the diet, they start out in the same way. You eat that Big Mac with all that cheese and all that grease and everything that goes down your gullet. Eventually, the lipids that are in there make it into your intestines. And I've mentioned already bile acids, for example, play an important role in emulsifying or solubilizing those lipids in the aqueous environment of your gut. In order to get into your body, the fats, fat-soluble vitamins and cholesterol have to make it across the wall of your gut. And so that's part of what I'm showing right here. I show it only for fats because fats have a little bit of an unusual way of making it across that gut. In your digestive system, that is in the lumen of your intestines, you have enzymes called lipases. And lipases, as we learned for the last exam, are enzymes that break down fats into, or glycerophospholipids into fatty acids and glycerol or glycerol phosphate or something. For fats to move across the lumen of the intestine, the fats have to, first of all, be cleaved of a couple of their fatty acids. So usually, two of the fatty acids get clipped off, leaving behind a monoacyl glycerol. The fatty acids get transported across the lumen, as do the monoacyl glycerols. And then, once they get to the other side, outside of the intestine, okay, they get reassembled back into a fat. It's an odd system. Now, it's not completely clear why that happens, but my own take on why this happens is if you think about what fatty acids are, they are basically detergents. And detergents help emulsify things also. So it may well be that getting across that membrane, this emulsification power provided by the fatty acids may actually help keep things soluble as they get across that membrane. Doesn't really matter why, the fact of the matter is that it does. This is what the way that that works. Cholesterol makes it across pretty much intact. Not pretty much, it is intact. It doesn't get broken down or changed into something else. Okay, now, as they get onto this side, the body has to now start dealing with them. And there's no bile acids on this side, that is the right side of this figure. There are no bile acids over there to emulsify things. So these guys have to get packaged up. And the packaging up that occurs in the first of a series of what we call lipoprotein complexes. Lipoprotein complexes are the way of protecting and moving lipids in the body. So as it suggests, they are complexes. And it says lipoprotein, meaning lipo meaning lipid, protein meaning protein. And so these arrange themselves into little ball-like things that you can think of, where the inside of the ball contains the lipid that's not water-soluble, and the outside contains the proteins that are fairly hydrophilic that interact with water very well. Well, the very first one of these that's encountered in the body for dietary lipids are the complex called chylomicrons. And chylomicrons are great big honking complexes. Okay? They are very large. And they pass into the lymphatic system. And from the lymphatic system, they get dumped into the bloodstream. And you might, and of course, what's contained in there? It's contained fat, contains cholesterol, contains fat-soluble vitamins. All those guys are packaged inside of the chylomicrons. And you think, okay, well, now I know how people have heart attacks because they've got these great big complexes. And they go and they plug stuff up. And the answer is they don't. Surprisingly, the biggest complexes don't have a problem with that. The biggest complexes float out eventually into your bloodstream. Your bloodstream grabs them and they start moving into your tissues. And your tissues are hungry. Your tissues want nutrients, your tissues want food, and they raise their hand and they start grabbing a hold of these chylomicrons moving through them. This is where in the capillaries this happens. And the chylomicrons get stuck because they're bigger than the capillaries that they're in. Well, when they get stuck, those little cells that are there secrete enzymes like lipases that start breaking down the fats that are inside of that chylomicron. Because the fats are full of fatty acids and glycerol that cells can use for energy. Well, what happens to the chylomicron at that point is it starts shriveling up. And as it shrivels up, it gets smaller and smaller and becomes something we call a chylomicron remnant. Chylomicron remnant. At that point, it's small enough that it now fits through the capillaries. And the flow of blood pushes it through, and it gets through the capillaries, goes into the venous system, and makes it back to the liver. Okay? No plugging, no blocking. No problems associated with that. It gets back to the liver, and the liver absorbs it. Okay? The liver absorbs the chylomicrons and all of the contents, because there's still cholesterol in there, there's still fat-soluble vitamins in there, and there's still some fat in there. So the liver, all of a sudden, we see, whoa, the liver's doing everything. Now the liver's playing an important role in lipid metabolism, not only glucose metabolism, but also lipid metabolism. And the liver is very critical for that. Okay? Well, the chylomicrons are not the only complexes that move around in our bloodstream. But in fact, there are other complexes known as, well, these are individual proteins. There are other complexes that carry things around in the bloodstream. Those other complexes include things like intermediate density or lipoprotein complexes, IDLs, low density lipoprotein complexes, known as LDLs, high density lipoprotein complexes, known as HDLs, okay, and a variety of others. And what you see on the screen is a listing of the individual proteins within those complexes. No, I'm not going to ask you to memorize which ones go to what. But you see, all of these guys are proteins that are found in various complexes. I didn't mention VLDL, very low density lipoprotein complexes. Okay. Everything except the chylomicrons in this column, okay, is secreted by the liver. Okay. The biggest, the fluffiest of these is the very low density lipoprotein complexes, the VLDLs. The next most fluffy of these are the intermediate density, the IDLs. The next most dense are the low density lipoprotein complexes, the LDLs. And the very smallest of those are the HDLs, high density lipoprotein complexes. Now, of these complexes, there's only one that's really associated with problems like we associate with stroke and heart attack. You hear of atherosclerosis, plugging of the arteries. This happens as a result of problems associated with the low-density lipoprotein complexes, the LDLs. It's the LDLs that your doctor is going to be most concerned about when they look at your cholesterol levels. Now, we'll see why that occurs in a minute, but I want you to understand that. Your doctor may well refer to LDLs as bad cholesterol. It's actually in the LDLs that the cholesterol concentration is the highest. Okay? The LDLs have the highest concentration of cholesterol. And your doctor may also look at another lipoprotein complex and call it good cholesterol, and that's known as the HDLs, the high-density lipoprotein complexes. HDLs appear to play an important role in actually lowering the cholesterol levels in your bloodstream because they're scavengers of cholesterol and problem structures, as we'll see. They grab them and then carry them back to the liver. So if you have a high level of HDLs, your doctor is probably going to be happy, because it means it's scavenging a lot of things that would otherwise cause you problems. Okay? Now let's think, or let's take a look then at how this movement occurs in the body and understand a little bit about what's going on with cholesterol. Okay? There's a chylomicron structure to show you. So there's the proteins on the outside in the green. And on the inside, we've got all those lipids that I've talked about. And all the other lipoprotein complexes are just like this in terms of structure, various balls of various things. Okay, so here this figure shows three pathways associated with movement of lipoprotein complexes in the body. Okay? The first of these starts on the right. Here's our dietary lipids coming from our intestines, and we can see the passage of those things through the intestinal wall, the packaging into the chylomicrons, like I've already described to you, and the movement of those chylomicrons into tissues. Okay? They get stuck and they get broken down into free fatty acids, and those get packaged back up into fat in adipose tissue. Adipose tissue is where fat is stored in your body. Not all of your cells store fat. In fact, most of your cells don't store fat. Fat is actually stored in specialized tissue called adipose tissue. So cells are grabbing those fatty acids. If they're not burning them up, then they are storing it away in adipose tissue somewhere. That leaves behind chylomicron remnants. And the chylomicron remnants now can do a couple of things. One is the chylomicron remnants can go back to the liver, as I explained. And that's the most common thing that they do. Okay? Right straight back to the liver, and you can see the liver absorbing them, and you don't see a green coming back out. So the liver doesn't release chylomicron remnants. Only the intestinal tissue and the lymph tissue has the chylomicron remnants. Well, the liver is sitting here and it's got all this stuff, and the cells of the body have various needs. We saw in the case of glycogen, for example, that the liver could absorb all that glucose, and when the body needed glucose, it broke down glycogen and it released that back out to the bloodstream so that the tissues would have it. The liver's got all this cholesterol. It doesn't have infinite capacity. It's got all this fat. It doesn't have infinite capacity. So we would expect it would have a way to take things in and a way to release things when they're needed. And that's exactly what it does. So if we look at what's happening with the movement of the fat and lipid tissue in the liver, okay, the most important pathway is the one on the far outer side in the sort of purplish color. This is the pathway that your liver, okay, releases materials out to the rest of the body. Well, what happens? The liver has to know that the body needs something. Okay? It has to know that the body needs something. I'm going to tell you what it does, and then I'm going to tell you how it does it. Okay? So what it does is it releases material to the body when it senses a need. And it packages up those lipids, the cholesterol, the fat, and the fat-soluble vitamins. It packages them up into other lipoprotein complexes. This pathway going out here involves packaging them up into something called VLDLs, very low-density lipoprotein complexes that I've already mentioned. They're the second fluffiest behind the chylomicrons. Those VLDLs go out to the target tissue. And they're just like the chylomicrons. They're big enough, they get stuck. The enzymes of the cells that want them start breaking that down, and the VLDLs get broken into smaller and smaller components. The VLDLs, broken down into the next component, the VLDLs become the IDLs. They're just smaller. And the IDLs get broken down into smaller complexes known as the LDLs. We're starting to get into trouble. Now, what's happened in going from VLDL to IDL to LDL? What's happened is those lipases have been grabbing more and more of that fat out of that little ball in the center. I like to think of it as the Oreo cookie with the middle. Okay? The Oreo center is disappearing. The cookie is getting smaller and smaller. But that cholesterol is still sitting there. Cholesterol does not get taken from the VLDLs. It does not get taken from the IDLs. And it does not get taken from the LDLs. Okay? We'll see in a minute how it is that cholesterol makes it into cells. So we can imagine that we started with X amount of cholesterol in the VLDLs, and we have Y amount of fat. By the time we've gotten down to LDLs, we might have 1/10 as much Y, right, of the fat. That is 1/10 Y of fat, but we still have 1X of cholesterol. So cholesterol is occupying the largest percentage of the lipid in the LDL. Well, what's wrong with that? Well, there's nothing wrong with that per se. The problem with the LDL isn't even directly cholesterol. It's an association with cholesterol. The problem with the LDL is that the LDL will have some fatty acids in there, in its fat, that are not very well protected from oxidation. They're better protected in the other complexes. Reactive oxygen species, I've talked about the importance, and I said that reactive oxygen species non-enzymatically will attack the first thing they hit. Well, the most easily oxidized things inside of your LDLs are some of the fatty acids. Damage to those fatty acids can result in a couple of things. One, some unusual structures in those fatty acids within the fat, and these are all in the fat, by the way. We can have cross-linking. We can have a bond between the fatty acid and something adjacent to the fatty acid. What if that thing adjacent to the fatty acid is your artery? That sucker is stuck there. You have an immune system that looks and says, okay, I'm looking for damage because I'm going to protect you. Right? Well, damage to LDLs, which is the most common place where damage occurs, damage to LDLs is a sign to the immune system, whoa, we've got to protect the body. We're going to bind to that. And they bind, and they bind, and they bind. And they engulf, trying to swallow that stuff that's in there. And when they engulf, what do they get engulfed with? A lot of cholesterol, because that's where the cholesterol concentration is the highest. These masses that occur where cross-linking has occurred or where attack has occurred are the foundation of what are called atherosclerotic plaques. And the appearance of these pre-plaque things are very foamy because of all the lipid and all the cholesterol that's here. There's a complex that's called foam cells. Okay? This is happening because of the attack of your immune system on these damaged fats in the LDLs. Well, there's all this cholesterol there gives everything the foamy appearance. And this is only happening in the LDLs, where the concentration of cholesterol is the highest. You can imagine that the higher the concentration of LDLs you have in your body, the more of a problem that you will have. And that's exactly what happens. So, that's the bad news. Here's this pathway by which this is traveling. And we see here that there's also a reverse pathway where these things get hauled back. And it's this reverse pathway that's very important for the liver's ability to understand how much the body needs. So I've told you about going out there. I've told you about making LDLs. Now we're going to follow this pathway backwards. And by the way, it looks like VLDLs are going to HDLs, and that's a little confusing. For right now, we'll just leave that as it is. But I want to follow this backwards path to get back to the liver. We're still following the purple path. All right, so let's think about what the liver has done. It's made VLDLs. Oh, yes, question, Leo. Yep. Yes. This is showing, you're exactly right, Leo. I apologize for that confusion. I should have started here. I started over here. This will make LDLs. This also can lead to LDLs, which is a little confusing, but yes, I should have started with the blue. Thank you, yeah. My own figure, I drew this figure, guys. Okay, all right. VLDLs, IDLs, LDLs, right? Going to tissue, and now we're going back to the receptors. Okay. Now, what the liver has done is it's made these things, it's sent them out, and some of them are coming back. Not all of them are coming back, though. When we get to this tissue, what happens? This tissue says, hey guys, besides fat and fatty acids, I need cholesterol. I need cholesterol. Well, how does it get cholesterol? It can't pull cholesterol out of there. It turns out that what cells do is they do a process called receptor-mediated endocytosis. Receptor-mediated endocytosis. This involves physically grabbing an LDL, and this only works for LDLs. It physically grabs the LDLs, and it internalizes the entire complex. That means that the cell gets all of the lipids that are there, the cholesterol, the fat, and the fat-soluble vitamins. Okay? Well, you can imagine that the more LDLs that get gobbled up by the cells, the less LDLs there are floating in the bloodstream, right? Okay. So you say, oh, well, I partly understand how that person's eating a dozen eggs for breakfast every day and they still have low cholesterol levels because they're internalizing all their LDLs. Well, that's part of the picture. Okay. You're partly right. But the more important thing is the fact that the LDL concentration has been decreased. The liver has on its surface, it has receptors called LDL receptors. These are complexes, very much like the complexes on this tissue, except for they're located now in the liver. When the LDL gets back to the liver, the LDL complex says, okay, I'm going to internalize you. So the liver now internalizes that LDL. Anybody with me? It sent out VLDLs, which became IDLs, which became LDLs. Whatever didn't get gobbled up by the rest of the body now is making it back to the liver, right? So what? Well, the so what is this? The more of the LDLs that make it back to the liver, the less the body took, right? So the liver, not being a stupid organ, actually being quite an intelligent organ, says, hey, I'm putting out all these VLDLs, and they're all coming back as LDLs. The cell doesn't need any more cholesterol. It doesn't need any more lipid. So what should I, as an intelligent liver, do? Lower the amount of VLDLs I'm putting out. And if your liver is functioning really well, it's reading that concentration of LDLs that are coming back, and it's adjusting how many VLDLs it's putting out. That's the person who's eating the dozen eggs every day and has low cholesterol, because their response system is understanding very well how much the body needs. It's reading it very well, and it's not exceeding the liver's capacity to absorb things. That's part of the reason why we try to adjust with diet. If you've exceeded your liver's capacity to hold on to this stuff, then it doesn't have this ability to grab it all coming back. And so what happens? The LDL concentration remains high. You guys follow that? Okay. So this monitoring by the liver of the LDLs being taken up by the LDL receptor tells the liver how many VLDLs to put out. Well, that doesn't always work well. As I said, liver may have exceeded its capacity. So both of those will contribute to have the body having too high of a concentration of LDLs. Now, I want to tell you a true story that happened in this class. And this happened with a student that used to sit right up in the front row. Of course, we weren't in this room at that time. She sat right in the front row every day. And she was a graduate student. And she was really very, very good. And I gave this lecture. And she came up to me one day. And she said, my son has this disease of cholesterol. And it's called familial hypercholesterolemia. And I said, oh, no, he doesn't have that. She said, oh, no, I'm pretty sure that's what the doctor said. And I said, no, no way. She said, yeah, he really does. I said, well, there's only a few people in the entire country who have this disease, okay? And it's very fatal, okay? Because what happens, let me tell you a little about the disease first. The disease, in this disease, people lack liver LDL receptors. Now think about, based on what I just told you, what would happen to your LDL levels in your body? They would go astronomical. Because the liver is constantly thinking, nothing's coming back here, guys. I got to put out more. The body is really, really hungry for all this stuff. I'm putting out as much as I can. And there's no sign, there's no feedback. The liver never gets the feedback because it has no receptor to get that stuff back. A normal, when you look at cholesterol levels, what people, doctor would consider a high cholesterol level is a reading of about 200. Above that, they'll start saying, okay, we're going to look at diet, we're going to look at drugs, because higher than that is going to be associated with an increased incidence of atherosclerosis. Okay? People who have hypercholesterolemia typically die, okay, by the time they're a teenager, right? This kid had before they did treatment, had a cholesterol level in his blood of over 700. Okay. Over 700. And the way they discovered it was he started developing these blisters on his knees. She showed me a picture of it. Blisters on his knees, and these were basically the equivalent of foam cells that were appearing on his body because there was no other place to put them. It was remarkable. Well, there's a very good ending to this story. He did have it. And at the time that he got this, they had just come out with the first of the anti-cholesterol drugs called the statins. And they had put him on these statins, and through this and also some drugs that blocked the reabsorption of the cholesterol that I talked about, okay, so the cholesterol could just go out in the feces, they got his blood cholesterol levels down to about 200, which would be borderline high for anybody, but way better than 700, and he's perfectly fine. If he'd been born 5 years before that, he would have been dead because you die of a heart attack with those things. So pretty remarkable thing. So I always give that as an example of, you know, modern medicine really does some pretty incredible things, and that was one. Oh, yeah. Okay. So I apologize for the confusion about the blue versus the purple, and I should have paid more closer attention to that. But blue was where I was talking about here, okay? The purple is, in fact, associated with the HDLs. And the HDLs, as I said, are made by the liver. The HDLs are scavengers. So the HDLs can help with damaged LDLs, can help with cholesterol that has escaped, for example, and it gets grabbed and cycled right back to the liver. Okay? So HDLs are good cholesterol, LDLs being very bad cholesterol. Okay. Let's see. Here's, I meant to show you this too. Receptor-mediated endocytosis. This is the way that those LDLs are getting into the cell. There are receptors there that will recognize proteins on the LDL and internalize it. And once it internalizes, all the different components get taken away, all right? And then the things that are not needed, okay, are just exported back out. Yes, Megan? Which type of cells are doing this? All the cells of your body. All the cells of your body, remember, need cholesterol in their membranes. And so this is what they're taking. And one of the ways that they're getting cholesterol. Remember, they can also get cholesterol by synthesis. So they can synthesize their own cholesterol as well. But all the cells can do this. Other questions? Yes? Are there cells that can't synthesize cholesterol on their own? Not as far as I know. Not as far as I know. Okay. Let me show you a foam cell. They're kind of ugly. Okay. These guys have engulfed LDLs and at the site of a wound, and they really get very foamy looking because of all the lipids that they contain. By the way, there's what a plaque looks like. The cells of the immune system that are gobbling these up are known as macrophages. I should tell you that also. The macrophages are what are attacking those damaged LDLs. Macrophages do the job in the immune system of swallowing everything up, and that's what they're trying to do here. Yes, sir? How come they can't make the foam cells? The ones that are the most likely to be damaged by oxidations are the LDLs. And so it's the damage that the immune system is recognizing. Yes? It's hard for me to put a limit on that. But I mean, a macrophage is a pretty good sized cell. And as they start engulfing things, they get bigger. But I couldn't give you a physical dimension. I don't know that. Yeah, back there. Is the immune response itself what causes the plaque? The macrophage part of it, yes. Yes, it is. Okay. Well, that covers what I want to say about cholesterol. We turn our attention next to things that have, back to metabolism. Oh, boy. And that's the subject here of fatty acid oxidation. So we've been talking about fats. We've been talking about lipids. Now we talk about how we break down fatty acids to get the energy from them. Fatty acids are the compounds in our body that actually have the greatest potential chemical energy of all the compounds we metabolize, greater than amino acids, greater than sugars. Okay? For a fatty acid about the length of palmitic acid, which has 16 carbons, there are roughly, depending on how you count them, about 134 ATPs that could be generated. So fats store a lot of energy in their fatty acids. A lot of energy in their fatty acids. And they store it because if you look at these fatty acids that are here, the fatty acids are all completely reduced. The more reduced things are, the more energy can be stored, because when we oxidize those, that energy is released. In our cells, fatty acids are attached to coenzyme A. So just like we saw acetyl-CoA, we have fatty acids attached to CoA. Acetyl-CoA is just acetic acid attached to CoA. If we attach palmitic acid to coenzyme A, we get palmitoyl-CoA. And that CoA provides, as I mentioned in class earlier, a handle for the molecule to be manipulated with within the cell. Okay? As we look at fatty acid oxidation, we will see that fatty acid oxidation occurs in units of two carbons. So the fatty acid oxidation is aimed at splitting off two carbons at a time. And if you think about it, those two carbons are what make acetyl-CoA. So the breakdown, the oxidation of fatty acid, the first major product of that, is acetyl-CoA. All the action in fatty acid oxidation occurs between what's described here as the alpha carbon and the beta carbon. I describe them as between carbons 2 and 3. There's carbon number 1, carbon number 2, and carbon number 3. All of the action that occurs in oxidation of a saturated fatty acid occurs between those two carbons. It's a four-step process to get that split off. And then once one acetyl group has been split off, the process repeats, 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 repeats. So fatty acid oxidation splits off two carbons every time. If we have 16 carbons, we have 7 splits, not 8, because the last one splits it in half, right? 4 into 2, okay? And that fat acetyl-CoA can be oxidized inside of the citric acid cycle. So we got a lot of material for the citric acid cycle. Fatty acid oxidation, as I mentioned before, occurs in the mitochondrial matrix, just like the citric acid cycle does. Okay. Fatty acids, as I said, have to be activated. So if a cell has grabbed a hold of that VLDL, for example, and has secreted some lipases. The lipases broke the fat down in there into fatty acids. Those fatty acids can be internalized into the cell. Those fatty acids inside the cell have to be attached to a CoA, and this is the way in which they get attached to a CoA. Okay, there's an enzyme, the name of which I'm not too concerned with, but there's an enzyme that will attach that CoA to the fatty acid. Now, I should also mention fatty acids don't have to get into the cell in the way I just described to you. So fatty acids can also travel in the bloodstream, but not freely. We don't want fatty acids traveling freely in the bloodstream because they can act like detergents, and we think of what detergents can do, they can denature proteins. So instead, fatty acids tend to be transported in the bloodstream by specialized proteins. Okay? And the specialized protein in our bloodstream that carries fatty acids is known as serum albumin, which I'm sure you have heard of. It's the most abundant protein in our bloodstream. So serum albumin can deliver fatty acids to cells. Well, however the fatty acid gets there, this fatty acid has to be activated inside of the cell. That occurs in the cytoplasm of the cell because that's the first thing that the fatty acid is going to hit when it gets inside the cell. Then something kind of curious happens. Okay? It turns out that oxidation of the fatty acid occurs in the mitochondrial matrix, which means the fatty acid has to get into the mitochondrial matrix. And here's the surprising fact of life, and that is that the fatty acid attached to CoA cannot make it across the inner mitochondrial membrane. So the cell has just wasted energy. It just put a CoA on there. It gets to the mitochondrion. The mitochondrion says, sorry, no go. At the mitochondrial membrane, there is an enzyme known as carnitine acetyltransferase that swaps a CoA for a carnitine. So the CoA that was put on there is removed, and a small molecule called carnitine is attached to the fatty acid, making acyl-carnitine. And the inner mitochondrial membrane has a transport system to move the acyl-carnitine in. Kind of odd, right? That's what happens. Inside of the mitochondrial matrix, the carnitine is removed and replaced by coenzyme A. Okay? So the net result is we have acyl-CoA, that is a fatty acid linked to a CoA inside the matrix, but we had to go through this little shuttle system to get it in there. Notice this is called carnitine acyltransferase 2. This was called carnitine acyltransferase 1. They're just doing the same reaction in opposite directions. Yes, sir? Okay, so this, I'm sorry, say it again. What goes out here? Okay, actually, I think this arrow's pointing the wrong direction. This should be moving up this direction. So it's carnitine that's swapped for the acyl carnitine. Okay, yep. Okay. Let's take an overview of the reactions that happen. The reactions of fatty acid oxidation are pretty simple, and you've actually learned them already. I'm going to go through them real quickly here, and I'll talk about them in a little bit more depth in the next lecture. Here's our acyl-CoA. The enzymes for fatty acid oxidation are in the mitochondrial matrix, and they've got a variety of names, but you'll notice I don't even bother to put the names up here. There's only two enzymes of fatty acid oxidation I think you should know the names of. The first one is actually right here. The very first reaction involves dehydrogenation of the acyl-CoA. That takes place between carbons 2 and 3, as I said, and creates a trans double bond. And this reaction is catalyzed by an enzyme known as acyl-CoA dehydrogenase. Acyl-CoA dehydrogenase. That's an acyl-CoA. It's a dehydrogenation reaction. No surprise in the name. Turns out our body has three of these enzymes. One that works on long-chain fatty acids. One that works on medium-chain fatty acids, that is the medium length of the chain. And one that works on short-chain fatty acids. The long chain one is found not in the mitochondrial matrix, but actually in the, an organelle called the lysosome. How long is long? Longer than about 22 amino acids. The other acyl-CoA dehydrogenases, the medium and the short, won't work on it. That guy is going to get moved to the lysosome so that the long chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase can do this reaction. And in fact, all of the reactions here will occur in the lysosome for very long ones until the fatty acid gets short enough, and then it'll be moved back to the mitochondrion. Okay? Now, why do I want you to know the name of this enzyme? I want you to know the name of this enzyme because it has a very important medical implication. The medium chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase and the short chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase are both found in the mitochondrial matrix. Okay? When you look at children who have died from sudden infant death syndrome, they are commonly deficient in the medium chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase. It's not an absolute relationship, but there is a correlation between the two. Mac. The reason it's there is because that's where the enzyme is located. I didn't say it couldn't make it in. I just said that it's oxidized inside the lysosome. So the physical presence of that long-chain fatty acid CoA, fatty acyl-CoA dehydrogenase is only present in the lysosome. I can't tell you why. That's the way the system evolved, but that's where it's at. Okay? Okay. So this enzyme is pretty important. So we see that the oxidation of medium and short-chain fatty acids occurring in the matrix, the long-chain fatty acids occurring in the lysosome. The next reaction of oxidation is hydration. Water is added. Okay? Again, it's occurring between carbons number 2 and 3. The hydroxyl goes on to position 3. The hydrogen goes on to position 2. That hydroxyl is oxidized from a hydroxyl to a carbonyl group. Creates this guy. And then the last, there's our enzyme thiolase that now cleaves the two carbon piece off and makes a fatty acid that's two carbons shorter. Now, I told you when we went through the citric acid cycle that if you learned the enzymes, succinate dehydrogenase, okay, fumarase, and malate dehydrogenase, you would learn the same things in fatty acid oxidation. This is the reaction of succinate dehydrogenase. Succinate dehydrogenase makes a trans double bond between carbons 2 and 3 of succinate. Okay. Fumarase adds water across the double bond, which is what this guy is doing. Malate dehydrogenase oxidizes the hydroxyl to a carbonyl group. Now, these enzymes are not fumarase, and I mean, they're not the same enzyme, but they catalyze the same type of reaction. In the case of fatty acid oxidation, the next reaction is cleaving that guy off. That's not found in the citric acid cycle. But that's how we get that acetyl-CoA. Okay, questions about that? That's a quick and dirty. I'm going to say a little bit more about it next time. You guys up for a song? All right, let us sing a song. The fatty acids carried by CoA, CoA, are oxidized inside the mitochondria. They get to there, as you have seen, by hitching rides on carnitine. Then it goes away when acids get oxidized. Electrons move through membranes. Yes, it's true, it's true. They jump from complex 1 onto CoQ, CoQ. The action can be quite intense when building proton gradients. And it's good for you when acids get oxidized. The protons pass through complex V, you see, you see. They do this to make lots of ATP, ATP. The mechanism you should know goes through the stages LTO, so there's energy when acids get oxidized. Okay, guys, have a fun weekend.